Good morning, everybody. How's everybody doing? It's a little weird. New time, new place. Good to see you guys, though. This is awesome. This is exciting. Comfy chairs, but why don't you stand up and let's worship together. Jesus, we just thank you for this morning. We thank you for this chance to be here, to have some comfy chairs to sit in, to just have a chance to worship you, have a chance to gather together. Pray that you would be in our time this morning. You would be in the midst of the worship. You would be in the midst of Cory's message. Right now, we just ask that you would center our hearts on you. Bring our focus in, bring our focus away from whatever's been going on this week into just undivided attention for you and for what you want to do this morning.
Oh. shout out your name. From the rooftops I proclaim that I am yours. I am yours. All that I am, I place into your loving hands, and I am yours. I am yours.
So I shout.
So I shout out your name. From the rooftops I proclaim that I am yours. I am yours. All that I am, I place into your loving hands, and I am. From the rooftops I proclaim that I am yours. I am yours. All that I am, I place into your loving hands. I am yours. I am yours.
Good morning. How fun to see you all.
It is fun to see you guys indoors.
I know. You guys can go ahead and take a seat.
I just want to say that from our perspective, you guys all have a rather angelic
Exactly. We see this nice
right
glow
now. Great
over your
halos
head.
Shine around you. I'm pretty sure we see you as you really are.
So, oh, now the lights come on.
Oh, you just lost a little bit of it, but it's still there. It's all right.
I know. Well, good morning.
Wow. So fun.
I know it's so fun to see some faces I haven't seen in a while either. And you have nice comfy chairs to sit on in this, I know, right? In this temperature that's controlled by programs, and it's really nice. So, my name is Christy. I'm one of the volunteers here at Bayside.
My name's Cory. I'm not one of the volunteers here.
Yeah. And we just have a few announcements for you this morning. So to get us started, if you have your phone and you would like to see what's going on at Bayside, go ahead and open up the Bayside app, or you can download the Bayside app. And inside, you will find information. There's also on the little notes that were handed out to you on your way in or after you were here already, there's a QR code. It's a little funny looking box with a bunch of black. It's kind of dark. If you put your camera on your phone over that, it will open up the Bayside app for you and give you all the latest and greatest information that you would like to know.
And there's a few things that you should know about that are coming up.
I know. We have a lot of exciting things coming up. So first of all, we're inviting you to stay for lunch afterward.
Woo, lunch!
I know. My stomach is already growling.
Who likes lunch?
Me, I'm already hungry.
I know.
Better not talk too long today.
It's gonna be no, yeah, never.
And we're gonna, you can head right out those doors, right on the other side where it says exit, because it will lead you to the courtyard where there are tables, and we are having a casual lunch of pizza and drinks, so join us for a quick opportunity to connect with each other.
I would also point out that door will also lead you to the bathrooms if you want to take the indoor approach, or you can walk out the back door and hang a right and follow that sidewalk all the way down. It will get you to the restrooms. If you have been on Pioneer Campus with us in the past, you're going to recognize those restrooms as the exact same ones that we've always used. But you're coming in from the opposite side. It's
exactly.
Like crazy. It's like Willy Wonka. It's
I know. So, little housekeeping. Keanu, hi.
We're a college student just came back.
I know. I just had to say hi because my college kids are in Virginia, and I just saw one of their friends. I know, right? So another thing, November, we're going to be having Serve Day. So we changed the date due to things are moving a little slower with the school districts right now due to COVID. So we couldn't get some finalized confirmation about projects until recently. So it's going to be November 14th. Mark your calendars. Invite your grandkids, your neighbors, whoever feels committed and want to see our community loved on and improved upon, and have them join us. More details will come out for Serve Day, November 14th.
Can I just add a really quick 2 cents on that? This is such a cool thing because we're going to do it Sunday morning. Like, right. If you haven't been a part of our Bayside Serve Day before, it's Sunday morning. It's during our normal like service time, but instead of us being at a service, we're going to be out doing the serving.
Exactly.
You guys catch that little play on words there, right? Mm-hmm. So we're doing the serving that because the idea of a service is that God called us all to be servants in this world. And so we live out worship by serving other people. So it is awesome. And as Christy said, invite people to do it. Because one thing that people do like to do is we do like to serve. We love to serve our community. Right? We love our community. So what a great time to get to come out and give back to our community at this point. So
yes, exactly. So mark the date, November 14th. Finally, this week, we're having a prayer and worship night at the church office on the 21st, Thursday. I think that's Thursday.
That is Thursday. I just want to point out, it's prayer night this Thursday. That's almost as exciting as having lunch after service, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Not stunned silence. Isn't that exciting?
Let's try that again.
Thank you.
That's almost as exciting.
Greg's excited, yes. Christina's excited. This is, not Christina. Cynthia's excited. The mask makes it really hard, Cynthia, all right?
And it's still a little dark
up here. The good news is you could hold me up in the alley, and I'd be like, Christina, why did you rob me? You'd be like, yeah, Christina, what's your problem? Thursday night, though, we get to gather for prayer. We want to pray about Bayside. We want to pray about our city. We really just want to pray about what God is doing because, in many ways, getting back onto Sunday mornings, 10 a.m., back onto this campus, for me, feels like we're getting our feet back on the ground, like the whole pre-COVID, get back to ministering to this city, this town, this place, and then God has awesome and great plans for us, and so kind of fun to be a part of that. So we just want to encourage you, come and be a part of our time, because it's all going to happen through prayer, and we're going to talk more about prayer in the service today, but prayer is how we engage with God and what he's doing with us and around us, because, well, it's a war.
So that's this Thursday at 7 at the church office. If you're unsure where our church office is, it's on the website, on our app, the address, all of that.
We got to practice something really quickly.
He's stealing my
show. I'm totally stealing her. She invited me up here, though.
I did. I said, why don't you tag team with me? But look, we're not even teaming.
Hit him with the chair in the ring. We got to get excited about prayer real quick. So let's fake it and be like, prayer night.
Woo-hoo!
Woo! Just your hands together. We're going to pray. Yeah. God's going to do awesome stuff because we're praying for it.
Exactly.
Who's there?
Yeah. I agree.
After you eat pizza, we'll ask for a show of hands who's coming, but I want you to be happy and satisfied first. Okay.
I have one last thing that I forgot.
Okay.
So we are taking the 7th through 12th graders to the Dixon Corn Maze on October 24th, which is a week. Is that? Wow, it's a week away.
A week from Sunday.
So also, if you have kiddos, 7th through 12th graders, grandkiddos, people that you know that would like to join us for that, it's always a super fun time. And so we were planning to do that, and it looks like it might be even raining a little bit, which will be make it even more fun because it never rains around here, right?
True.
I know.
Very true.
So let's go ahead and pray before we get started, and I'm super happy to see all of you. So, dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this morning and just the opportunity to be inside in the theater. I'm here to worship you, Lord, and I thank you for just that we have a place to be. And I pray, God, that we would continue to look to what you have us be in our community and how we meet the needs of those in our community and how we continue to manage and handle all of the things and the differences with COVID and how we love on each other despite all of the changes. I pray that you would bring comfort to those who aren't able to be here with us and draw them back when they are ready, Lord. And we love you so much. I pray for Cory this morning that you will give him the words that you want him to share with us and that our hearts will be open to hear from you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Wow, that was a perfectly timed prayer. because Greg able to sneak up here and give me my clicker. I'm out of practice being in front of people with a clicker. So we just did this really fun thing where we just told you guys all about the stuff that's happening, what Bayside's going to be doing, some things that are coming up. And I think it's so fun this morning if we're going to pick up with our topic we started last week, which is all about spiritual warfare. And so I want to just kind of swing us from, hey, here's the stuff we're doing that we can see and wrap our heads around, to all the stuff that's going on that we can't see and we can't wrap our heads around. And so, oh my goodness, look at that. There's this amazing like spirit shadow on, never, I got to get out of the way. I'm going to get used to that. Revelation 12, read this with me. This is so fascinating. Then there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon and his angels. And the dragon lost the battle. And he and his angels were forced out of heaven. This great dragon, the ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, the one deceiving the whole world, was thrown down to the earth with all of his angels. Then I heard a loud voice shouting across the heavens, "It has come at last, salvation and power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers and sisters has been thrown down to earth, the one who accuses them before our God day and night. And they have defeated him by the blood of the Lamb and by their testimony. And they did not love their lives so much that they were afraid to die. Therefore, rejoice, O heavens, and you who live in the heavens, rejoice. But terror will come on the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down to you in great anger, knowing that he has little time." Isn't that a fascinating passage? To think that there's this story behind the story we can see. There's a story behind the last year and a half of our lives. Story behind all the political stories that we hear about. There's a story about a world that's going on that happens in heaven and happens on earth, that's in the spiritual realm, that is having an impact upon this world as it was having an impact upon heaven. That there's just this incredible truth that is oftentimes incredibly invisible to us. And that's the big point and big picture of what Paul has led us into this last part of this discussion of Ephesians, to understand that we live in the real world, if you will. But the real world is both physical and spiritual. And we can only sense and see the world through our physical senses, our eyes, our ears, right? All those things. But God is also revealing that you should know and you should be aware of what's going on behind the scenes, because it can still have a huge impact on your life. In fact, what he's about to tell us this morning is all the ways in which we prepare ourselves or arm ourselves or guard and protect ourselves from all that is happening. Because notice that last part, Satan, the deceiver, the ancient serpent, the accuser, has been kicked out of heaven. So he can no longer stand in heaven and make accusation against you, against to God, which is really awesome, by the way. And that all happened because, as he said, the blood of the Lamb. Right? Jesus' death, his payment, is what caused Satan to get booted. He can no longer stand before God and bring up your sin and your past. That's what he's saying right there. Satan can no longer stand before God and be like, "Look at Robin. Look at all she did. We should really condemn her." And he's like, "I'm sorry, Jesus stepped in. He already paid for all of her sin." Right? God can no longer stand up and say, "Look, Rich, look at all of Rich's sin. He's got all this huge background. You're just going to let all this go, God?" And I was like, "No, we're not going to let it go." Jesus stands and goes, "I already paid for all of his sin." I really love saying names up here because everybody like, "Oh no, he's going to say my name next." Usually I just go with Steve's and Nancy's because I can hit like four or five of you all at once. But this is what he's saying. You know what? This is what he's done. Satan can no longer accuse you before God because all the accusations have been put to rest. It's like a court of law. The guilty verdict has already gone out, and Jesus took the punishment for the guilty verdict all on himself, which means our sin is all done away with in God's eyes. I mean, that's incredible. Then notice it says, though, that's how they overcame Satan, but also by the word of their testimony, their story of how God, how Jesus came into their life, how they became aware of it, how they lived it, how they shared it. That's an incredible thing, and the effect was this, that they realized who it was that they really loved and who they really followed and what life was really worth, this life, and what more it means, what more goes into it. So it's a really fascinating picture of coming back to this idea that we're talking about, which is just the spiritual warfare. What does this mean? How does this impact our life? And so we're going to let Paul kind of just take us right back to where we left off last week, which was Ephesians 6:13, where he says, "Therefore, put on every piece of God's armor, so you will be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. And then after the battle, you will still be standing firm." This is picturesque. He's going to have you visualize the image of a Roman soldier. And so if you think in terms of like movie terms like I like to, then think like Gladiator, right? Maybe you think about, any one of the old movies, like Braveheart, right, where they just got the physical weapons and shields and spears and, I mean, whatever image comes to mind. But he's saying, look, there's this sense of you got to have armor when you go into a battle. You're going to have armor when you fight because you're going to need it to protect yourself. But here's the thing. Satan is not going to physically attack you. So the good news is you don't have to wear physical armor. You can still wear all your cool clothes, your great threads. You can still be stylish, right? You don't have to be, you know, wrapped up in metal or anything like that. But he is simply saying, though, there is a spiritual battle. Satan is going to come after your heart and your mind. That's where the battle is fought, right? Which has kind of become a simple sort of tagline in warfare in the modern age, which is like we're out to win hearts and minds, right? That's a phrase that we use because we're trying to turn enemies into friends. This is part of the picture that is really being put in front of us here, is that he's saying Satan knows what to go after. He's not going to physically scare you. He's not going to attack you. He's not going to leave, you know, fang marks in your arm. He's going to try to leave fang marks in your mind, in your heart. He's going to try to fill it with doubt. He's going to try to fill it with fear. He's going to try to come at us and use those things that are already part of our life that are instigated by the physical world around us. And this last year is a great year for fear and worry and all those other things. So he's saying, here's just some things you need to be safe, to be protected, which is him saying, not only do you have access to this, but it's enough. It's all you need to have. It's everything that you need to be able to stand up and stand firm. And there's a sense in which the verb tense here in the Greek is a little bit clearer. He's saying, you already have it. Keep it on. Keep wearing it. Keep trusting in this. Every day, make this a part of your life. In a sense, ultimately, what he's going to be talking about is make this a habit. But let's finish the rest real quick. He says, so stand your ground, putting on the belt of truth and the body armor of God's righteousness. For shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news so that you will be fully prepared. Fully prepared, fully equipped, that you can stand at the end of the battle, at the end of the fight, that you aren't going to take any hits that are going to knock you off your feet. And so we're going to walk through kind of what this means, but understand the practical side of this, because this is going to be kind of in a vivid spiritual language to some of it. He's just talking about habits. He's talking about you've got to make these things part of the habits of your life. These things are all things that we have to get so used to, so acquainted with, so clear in our understanding and part of how we keep them in our life, that they become the stuff that we do when we don't have time to think about what to do, right? They're the reflexes. You know that, you know how this works all the time. We do this all the time. You know how you drive to work every morning when you drive the same way? Like you don't think about, okay, how am I going to get to work? Where am I going to turn? What am I going to do? You just start driving. And most of the time you get to work, you don't actually really remember the drive. Like, isn't that a weird feeling? Sometimes you're like, wait a minute, what happened? How did I get here? How long have I been driving? I don't remember any of it. You know, part of that is very cool because your brain actually shuts off part of itself to save energy. The part of your brain that records memory, when you're doing that thing you do every single day, it's like, we don't really need to remember this for the 1,000th time. Right? It's not going to be that memorable. Unless something memorable happens and that part kicks in really fast, like accident, brake lights, all of a sudden you remember that part. You're like, whoa, okay, that was memorable, right? But otherwise, your brain turns that part off like, no, we're just going to go with our habits, right? It's fine. Our brains are cool like that. They really are. They're amazing. It's also why we train people to do things that they don't have to think about in case there's going to be a crisis or an emergency. It's because you don't always have time to think when something bad is going to happen or when something difficult is going to happen or just something unexpected happens. I had one of our students, or several of the students, back when I was a youth pastor, graduated high school, joined the military, and went overseas to Iraq or Afghanistan. And I remember one of them was coming back, and he was telling me just about his tour that he had. And you know, he was saying, you know, all the training they put you through has to do with you being ready for when people start shooting at you. So that you know how to dive to the ground, you know how to locate where it's coming from, you know how to fight, shoot back, how to reload, how to clear jams, how to communicate. You know what everybody's going to do, and you don't think about it because the fear is going to be there, and you're not going to be able to even think clearly. He says, but you know what's really funny? It's the first time that they shot at us, we all stood around and went like, wow, I think people are shooting at us. He says, we stood there, we're watching, and it's like, things are dinging off the ground, and we're like, is this really happening? I mean, you know what you're going into. You know in your head, but at the same time, that first moment is just shock, and then somebody yells, get down! And then they all dropped to the down and ran to cover, and then they went into the routine of doing it. He said, that only happened the first time, but the first time, you're like, what the heck? Who would shoot at me? I'm a nice guy. But this is all part of the point of when you need training and we need practice and we need habits so that they kick in when we're like, wait, what am I supposed to do with this again? We can't always think it through. That's the idea behind being a soldier, but it's the idea behind so much of life. So much of our routines are based on our brain saying like, yeah, you know what, we know how to do this. We don't have to think about it anymore. Like, you know, tying your shoes. You think about the last time you tied your shoes? Probably this morning, but you probably didn't have to think really hard. You probably could even multitask. Even I can talk to someone while tying my shoes because I'm that good at tying my shoes. I can't do that with everything. Just letting you know, like tough stuff. So what we're about to talk to, as you listen to this, what I hope you hear is, how do I make that a habit in my life? How do I make this something that I think about every morning when I start my day, or when I'm going into a meeting, or I'm stepping out the door, or I'm about to wake up my kids, right? Or I'm whatever it might be, but that this is the stuff that I'm putting on my mind and my heart and my life, and I'm resting and I'm trusting in. So he walks us through this. The first thing he talked about was put on your belt of truth, right? And this is great, but we think of belt and belt. Well, we just think like, hey, it's a nice belt. I got it at JCPenney's, right? It's a good place. It's JCPenney's call out for you right there. So you know, that's a belt, right? It just holds my pants up, right? Keeps me dressed. That's nice. But that isn't exactly what a belt was, and I think it's kind of fun to know this. The belt is actually a little closer to a girdle. Come on, chuckle. Girdle, right? Bunch of tough Roman soldiers, they're all wearing girdles, but it's hard leather. It protects their abdomen. It goes all the way down to their knees and their thighs because, as we know, ancient Roman tough guys fought in miniskirts. They all did. Because otherwise you trip over your big long robe because nobody had invented pants yet, I guess. I don't know why. But that's why they wore this thing. It went all the way down. In fact, the actual word would be closer to saying your slip, which is the most unmanly thing you can wear. But in Roman soldiers, you didn't make fun of them for putting on their leather sheath slip because it was underneath. It was actually what connected their bottom armor with the top piece. It kind of holds the whole middle together. In many ways, this is the foundation. Truth is the foundation piece. Everything that we know and we believe that we stand on has got to be based on truth. If you remember that Revelation passage, chapter 12 that we read, right? What did it say? What had kicked Satan out? They had overcome him by the blood of the Lamb. Jesus' death, Jesus' resurrection, that is the objective, ultimate truth. That's the ground that we stand on. It's the chair that you sit on that holds you up. It's not subjective, meaning it's not a matter of your perspective. It's not about how I think about it. It's not how I see it. It's not that part of it. It's what's actually physically real, like gravity is real. Even if you don't pay attention to it, but you trip, you're going to fall because gravity is always there to catch you in a really harsh fashion. Right? Always. He never quits. He never takes a day off. It's always there. That's truth. It's always there. It never takes a day off. It's always going to be there. And he's saying, this is what the cross is all about. Jesus has accomplished this all for the whole world, not just for me, not just for you, but everybody. He's died for the sins of the world. It's his blood that was shed as an absolute, objective, historical, physical, and heavenly, spiritual fact. Wow. Just turn to somebody like, that is a lot of truth right there. Because we don't say amen a lot like during the middle of a sermon, but maybe we should. But that's a lot of truth. Like, that's a big deal. That's really good news, though, because that's what we stand on. And when it comes to truth, you want truth to actually be real, honest, accurate truth. You don't want it to be subjective, especially when we're talking about body armor, right? How many of you guys want to have body armor that doesn't actually stop bullets? I mean, that doesn't sound very good. I mean, we like this vest. It's not made out of Kevlar. It's made out of wool, but it looks nice. It makes you look slim. Well, that's nice, except for when they shoot at you, and then they hit you, and then it goes right through you, right? Then it doesn't do any good. That's what subjective armor, right? It wouldn't hold up to anything. You need it to be the real thing. Truth has to be the real thing, or it's just an opinion. And when things get difficult or things get tough or things get challenging like they are on repeat in life, you need something real to stand on. And that's what God is offering us. This is what Paul is saying, like, good news, you guys. This is yours. Just make sure you keep coming back to this truth, that this is what you trust in, that this is what you believe in. Because if you don't know the truth, how will you know when you're being told a lie, right? Because this is what Satan does. He brings lies and he brings accusations. And those lies and those accusations are going to be based on all kinds of stuff. A lot of it is going to be based on us. It's going to be based on our past. It's going to be based on our past history. It's going to be based on things we've done. Do you really think, do you really believe that God can do that? Do you really think that you're worthy of that? Do you really think that that's going to be okay? Do you really think God could overlook that or accept you or love you? And if we don't have a sense of this is the truth and it's bigger than me. Those doubts are what penetrate into our hearts. They penetrate into our minds. And he feeds off of that, or he feeds off the lie that, like, why do you even need that? You're better than that. You're good. You've pulled yourself up by your own bootstraps for so long. You're smart enough. You're good enough. And doggone it, people like you all by yourself. Why do you need God? You probably don't actually need him. Right? Truth brings us back to the ground of, like, no, I don't. I need him. But we don't know how to identify what is a lie if we don't actually already know what the truth is. Have you ever caught your kids in a lie? And you know it's a lie because you can see the truth clearly? Yeah, look, that was an amen right there. That's what I'm talking about. Okay, yes, right? You know. I mean, I love it. I still remember the day that I caught Madison stealing saltwater candy out of Christie's purse. As she's hiding it behind her back, and as the saltwater strings are dangling down her face, and I'm like, did you take your mom's candy? She's like, oh. I'm like, I love it that I'm so much smarter than you. Okay, it's not much of a challenge right now, but it's so awesome. So clear. You're like, the truth makes this so clear. I'm looking at the evidence. This is such an incredible thing to know the truth. To walk through this world and this life when there's all this fake news and all these other problems in this world and all these things, and to know, like, wow, there is some foundational truth that can't be touched. It's always going to be true. Changes the world. Because our enemy, Satan, is going to go after you, and he's going to attack you at the level of your identity in Christ, how you see yourself in this world, what makes you important, what makes you valuable, what makes you unimportant, what makes you unvaluable, come at it either direction. He's going to attack at that place, though. He's going to always bring up the past. He's always going to aim for whatever weaknesses you might carry around in yourself. And we have to constantly come back to the truth to hear God's voice, to know what it is that he wants for us, because Satan will say anything to keep you from understanding your importance. And I hope you hear this, because Paul has made this argument through the whole book, how important you are to God. We talked about it just briefly last week, where it said you need to humble yourself under God's mighty power, because at the right time, he wants to exalt you. He wants to raise you up. He wants everyone to see how glorious you are because of how glorious he made you. How important you are in this, yeah, awesome spiritual sense, but also how important you are in this battle that is going on. Because you are one of these soldiers in this analogy that is actually rescuing people from this darkness that is Satan. That is pulling people out of the lies and out of the deception and out of the confusion and into the truth. And it's not just about protecting you. It's about rescuing and bringing other people into it as well. And Satan can no longer play any role in heaven. He can no longer do any harm to God. He can no longer have any effect there. But he can keep people from following God by lying to them. And he can keep us from being effective, ultimately by discouraging us or just distracting us. Right? Because that's all he really has to do to come at us. And distraction is such a great way just to get us not thinking about the truth, to get us away from it. I mean, and as American people with great resources and our lives may be frustrating at times, but they're not usually under direct attack, I mean, in terms of scares. Most of our worries are about tomorrow, not immediately this day. Because, I mean, when life has really gotten bad and things are bad today, then you have an incredible focus on God. That's when prayer night on Thursday sounds like the best news you've heard all day. You're like, I'm going to prayer. I need God now, right? That's how we flow. And that's us as human beings. But Satan knows, if I can just get him distracted, if I can just get him off course, if I can just get something else in front of them and get him away from engaging with this truth, remembering this truth, living in this truth, putting this on as they start their day, as they go to their work, as they go to their job, as they work with their kids. And he knows that he can get us off track and far enough away that we become ineffective. Or, frankly, that becomes the next step. He's just getting us discouraged. We can start believing the messages of the world around us. All right, so that's truth. And I'm kind of laboring on truth. I can't spend this much time on everything else. But this is the big piece. And this is, I think, one of the best news pieces ever. That God is showing you what is absolutely true. And I should add this. Here's the cool thing. Objective truth is so awesome. But you know what's really fun about it? After it talked about the blood of the Lamb is how they conquered him, it was also through their testimony, which means their story, what they experienced, what they saw, how it impacted their life, how it changed them. This is the part where it gets personal, because you guys have a story. Jesus came into your life at some point, and everybody's story is a little different. Paul tells his story all the time, by the way. He's not ashamed of the fact that it's a subjective, like, I was walking on the road ready to arrest Christians when God blinded me with the light, smacked me upside the head, left me blind for 3 days, and then, whoop, opened my eyes. And I mean, it's a whole crazy, cool story. Other people's story just includes going to Sonic Burger to go to work where they met Jesus. But everybody's got a story. I continually love the Sonic Burger testimony. It's my favorite. It's not my story, but it's somebody's in this room. It's great. But God works everywhere, right? He's just saying, you've got your own story, and it's personal, and it's real. And you know what? It's true because it's based on God's objective truth story. It all goes together, and it's a great, great thing that we have. So the next piece he says was put on the body armor of righteousness. So put on God's righteousness is what he's saying. God has given you righteousness. Put it on. And this is really important to understand the distinction. He's not saying put on your righteousness. He's not saying you are right, therefore hold on to your rightness and put that rightness on. He's saying God is right. Just say that with me. God is right. Say this too. I am wrong. I'm not sure if we nailed that one or not. Could have been the masks, could have been the like, I don't know, it was harder to say. But this is such a significant little thing. This is actually not little, this is huge. In fact, all the next pieces of this really come down to just describing what we call the gospel, the good news, this crazy news of what God has done, what he's allowing us to receive and experience all through Jesus, all through his son, all because of the cross. He's saying you are now being given God's own righteousness. You are right before God. It's a word that it just means this, that because your relationship with Jesus, you are now qualified as righteous. You're in that courtroom and you were guilty as sin because you weren't right, you were wrong. And Jesus stood up and said, I'm taking all his guilty as sinness upon myself on the cross and I'm dying with it. And guess what? It's all done. And now you know what that makes you? It makes you right. Because it's God's right. God's righteousness in you, on you, for you, available to you. And it's there to protect you every day, to remember and know when Satan tells you lies about who you are and what you should do and what you can't do and how you fail, to remember and go, wait a minute, I stand right with God. It's the one relationship I never have to worry about it's going to change. Other people may fluctuate. Other friends may fluctuate. Family may fluctuate. But you know, not with God, not with my Heavenly Father. He is always going to see me as his righteous son or daughter. Always. Because all of my unrighteousness was already taken by Jesus. And he says, you've got to remember that. You've got to put that on. Remember, this is an action. Equip yourself. Put it on. Put it in your mind. Walk through this life knowing, no. A lot of things can go wrong in this world, but not that. That is always mine. That is always with me. Here's how Paul put it in 2 Corinthians. He said, for God made Christ who never sinned to be the offering for our sin so that we could be made right with God through Christ. Jesus, who knew no sin, took all of our sin upon him that we could be in this right relationship with God. That simply means this. My failures are not fatal in my relationship with God. Another phrase we know, failure is not fatal, and especially not in this relationship, especially not when it comes to God as your Heavenly Father. I mean, he is saying, yes, you know what, you're going to fail. Those times are going to come. Those moments are going to happen. That's going to be a real thing, but you know what, none of them are fatal. All of them are God saying, like, okay, that was real. That sin just happened. That was a huge mistake. There's going to be natural consequences that I'm not going to take away or solve for you, otherwise you wouldn't learn anything. I accept you as you are, but I'm not going to leave you as you are. God as a father is a disciplinarian. He will keep working in our lives to help us get back onto the path where our rightness lives out in our actual choices, our habits. And he's going to show us how much better that rightness is than the sinful way of which we grew up thinking, just living in this world. It's going to transform. It's going to change us. But we can always know as we walk through this world, no failure can keep us away. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. It's another one of Paul's famous statements. Things in heaven, things in earth, angels, demons, people, persecution, swords. I mean, he goes through the whole gambit. None of it can separate us from the love of God because of what Jesus Christ has done and accomplished for us. So he's saying, put it on. Remember, in the morning, put it on. Know, reflect, hang on to, believe in, trust in that righteousness. And then he says to strap on peace, right? Remember, that was your sandals. You got to put on your piece of the gospel of peace. This is a huge deal. So this is part of your outfit you got to wear. You got to remember that you're going to live in peace and have peace. And notice this. It's not guilt or regret of the gospel. It's the peace of the gospel. And the only reason I bring that up is because many of us grew up in a faith environment or a church environment or around some people that we thought were church people or godly people, and the way they always left us was with a sense of guilt and a sense of regret. It was all about shame. It was all about sin. And that's part of the story. That's part of the thing we got to come to grips with, not my rightness. But you know what? And you're living in the gospel, when you're living, then we live in peace, not in guilt, not in regret. It's because it's been done. It's been taken care of. So now it's peace that we walk in. It's peace that we live in. It's peace with God. It's peace with others. And it's peace with ourselves. You know how great it is to be at peace with the world around us? Peace with the people around us? I mean, when you have a heart filled with peace, a mind that is resting on peace, not anxiety, not fear, not hurt, not anger, not frustration, not pain, how different does that make you as a person? How do you interact with people differently? I remember when I was in high school, I had a buddy that came over to the house, and we decided we were going to walk down to Folsom Lake, which is about a mile down the road from where I grew up. And just a long blacktop road that turns into a gravel road for a portion. And we were 15, so this made sense to our thinking, but we thought, why should we carry any extra stuff that we'll just have to carry it back? So we decided to go with absolutely nothing other than our swim shorts. No towel, no shirts, no shoes. For a mile on blacktop, and we're like, piece of cake. Which it was, for about 10 feet. And then it gets really hot, but we did discover that if you jog, it's not quite as hot. And it just became a story of running from one little bit of shade to another. The problem is some of the shade was off the side of the road, which was filled with like star thistles, all kinds of like real weird weeds. But it was so hot, we couldn't stand the blacktop. So we were like diving into these things. We made the whole journey, got there. I always loved too, we never thought about bringing water. We're going to the lake. Should we bring anything to drink? Never thought about that. Just weird. Side note, has nothing to do with anything. It's funny how that just comes to mind, though. We ran, made it all the way there and made it all the way back, and we survived, except that our little tootsies were not quite the same that next day. And you know what? Next time my friend came over and said, let's go to the lake, we said, let's wear shoes. Because, right, you need shoes. You need the protection. It's this insulation from the hardness of the ground, the hardness of life. Right? Peace is this thing that comes in that it softens who we are. It brings patience as a reality to our life. Because we're not living out of the worry or the anxiety or the stress. We can take a deep breath. We can calm it down. We can remember, you know what? I've got peace with God. Not only that, but he's given us a way to be at peace with. They don't have to agree with me. They don't have to like me. I can be okay with that. I can be at peace with them. I can love them still. I can care about them still. Doesn't mean I have to do what they want or what they think is best, because I may disagree and they may be very wrong. But I can be at peace with them. And especially, how great is it to walk through life and to be just at peace with yourself? Just know that God has gone so far because of how much he thinks about you already. And he's got this plan for your life. He not only has invited you to know him, but he's set you free from your sin and your past and your background. And that he wants to equip you and fill you with all of his purpose in this life. He's got great, great things and great plans for us. It takes us to this next one, which is the shield of faith. It says, in addition to all these, hold up the shield of faith to stop the fiery arrows of the devil. Right? And this definitely brings me back to all the classic movies. I'm thinking Gladiator, Braveheart again, all this stuff, right? Where they're always going to combat, and you know, the war always starts with them lining up in their big lines, and they're there, and they got their shields, and then they got a bunch of guys with bows and arrows who like launch their arrows at each other, and they're just shooting at each side, trying to take out as many guys as possible. And the movies, of course, they always wait till the last second, then they all lift up their shields and they catch all the arrows, like, right? It's great. And I'll never forget watching Braveheart for the first time, because I thought it was so cool that when they held up their shields, you could actually see like the arrows points like come through the shield. Now I never thought about like, well, that would be actually rather terrifying. So like just arrows like coming right through. And but that's the idea. So you've got these shields to protect you. But can you imagine being the guy who was on his way to the war that day and he was running out the door and he forgot his shield? And all of a sudden they're like, shields up, and you're like, yeah, boom, right? I mean, you're gone. You're just like, oh, what, you forgot your shield? Like, what is wrong with you? I just love the picture. He's saying, keep putting all of these things on. Why? Don't go out your door. There's a war going on. You go out there without your shield, you're just like easy target for the snipers to pick off. He's saying, Satan's going to come right at the heart, right at the mind. He's going to come right at you. So keep the shield of faith with you. And the shield of faith is pretty awesome, actually. Because so often with faith, it's hard to know exactly what we're talking about. Like, okay, I believe in God. Sure, yep, I believe it. I have faith. What is that? How does it interact with my life? But the idea of this is that to trust God with all the things that you can't control about tomorrow. You may have heard this, but psychologists and studies that have been done have found that most of the anxiety, but literally 90% of the anxiety that you and I feel, struggle with every, any given day, 90% of it is fears and anxieties about things that aren't even likely to happen. They're like, they're on the borderline of like, that might be irrational. 90% of them that get the best of us. That means 10% of them are legit, are real, things that are concerning in life. And that's all, there are things that are real, that are rough. Those are things we struggle with anxiety, but the ones that are about tomorrow, we can't control, we can't change. All throughout the New Testament, Jesus is saying, turn those fears and those anxieties over and trust in God. Trust in that he's got tomorrow. Tomorrow will be okay because God's going to be there too. Live your day with tomorrow in mind. Plan for tomorrow. That's all good. But don't let it become your anxiety. Don't let it get the best of your heart and your fears. Trust in him. Maybe one of the best stories that goes with it is the story of Jesus when he's in the boat with his disciples and they're out in the middle of the night in a boat. You ever think about this? Like they're in a rowboat with the sail thing, but it's in the dark. I mean, there's no electric lights. They can't see the shore. It's one of those crazy moments you're like, Jesus led them in the middle of a lake in the dark. That had to be against everything Peter believed in. Like, you don't sail across the lake in the dark at night. I'm a professional. But Jesus said to do it. So they do it. And then Jesus has the audacity to what? Fall asleep. Right? He's sleeping in the back of the boat, which is fine normally, but then a storm kicks in. Wind, waves, right? Waves are coming over the bow of the boat. It's filling the boat up. They're trying to get the water out. The disciples are all legitimately panicking, right? And they're looking back, and there's Jesus. Snoring. I mean, how inconsiderate to be sleeping through our panic, right? I mean, and there they are panicking, and they hold off as long as they can, which I think is kind of comical. They're like, well, I don't want to wake Jesus up. Like, why? Because I don't want to be the guy that breaks first, right? Because I'm running barefoot over blacktop. I don't want to be the guy that admits I can't do this, right? I this is too scary or hard. So nobody wakes up until they're at the absolute point where they're like, Jesus, wake up. What is wrong with you? Don't you care if we die? Like, because we waited to the moment where we're like, we're going to die. It's time to wake him up, right? No, we're not waking him before that, but we're dying now. So they yell at Jesus, don't you care about us? Right? Don't you care? Like, here's our cares. Here's our concerns. This is what we would call a very valid fear, by the way. The boat's sinking. We're going to drown. We haven't even invented life jackets yet, right? I mean, we're going down for sure. They wake up Jesus. He just gets up, and he looks at these guys, and he's like, what's with the little faith? It's okay to laugh. I mean, I'd be terrified if I was there, but that's his response. Just a storm, just a boat sinking, just physical reality. Just a physical boat. You're just physical guys. We're just all going to go under. What's with the little faith, guys? And he just says to the wind, be quiet. And then the wind gets quiet. And then it says the disciples got really afraid, which I always think is awesome. Like, that's fascinating. There they are. The calm has hit. And now they're even more afraid because they're afraid of Jesus. And they're like, oh, he can do that. Wow. That's that we didn't quite know that was in the deal. But it's really interesting because later the disciples asked Jesus, increase our faith. Like we know, we got little faith. You keep telling us, we got little faith, we got little faith. How do we get big faith, Jesus? And Jesus says, you only need little faith. All you need is faith the size of a mustard seed and you can tell the mountain, go jump in a lake and the mountain will do it. You don't need a big faith. I'm not saying you got to have a bigger faith. You just need to actually use your faith. You need to pull it out. You need to actually practice trusting and believing because it's going to be based on what God has done for us. The objectivity, the fact that Jesus died on the cross, the fact that you walk subjectively free, you've felt it, you've experienced it, you know what he's done in the past, you know the answers to prayers, right? He's saying, you guys should have learned to trust me because you've walked with me. You've seen the truth, you've heard the truth, believe, follow. Saying you just have to employ the faith you have. You don't have to have some kind of mountain of faith. How do we even measure that? Just take the faith you have for tomorrow and be like, God, I need your help trusting you with tomorrow. Here's some real problems. Here's some real worries. Here's some real concerns. Frankly, God, here's some unrealistic fears, some unrealistic concerns. I might need your help with those as well. I want to trust you. I'm going to give you my tomorrow. Remember in Revelation how it ended? They didn't love their lives so much so that they were afraid to die. May or may not be the best translation, but it means that they didn't love their life so much that they were unwilling to. they were willing to say, you know what, God, wherever you take me, wherever you lead me, I'm going to trust you through the journey. The circumstances sometimes look like a storm. In fact, I love that picture because, frankly, doesn't life feel like it's a real life? It's physical. There's physical wind. There's real waves. There's real problems. Maybe they're not an actual boat on an actual lake, but life is like taking me down. And it feels like Jesus might be sleeping in the back of the boat sometimes. Is he paying attention? Did he hear my prayers? And of course, the answer is no, he didn't. Unless you pray them on Thursday night in our office. Didn't see that coming, did you? I know. Bring your faith with you every day. That's what he's saying. When you get up in the morning, don't start your day until you start with, God, I trust you for today. This is so key. This is such a big deal. This is a part of what we actually have to do and say. It can't just be a passing thought. Passing thoughts don't count as prayer, really, because they don't even lodge in our own hearts. They often need to come out of our mouths. Even if we're praying by ourselves in a room, I'm not even kidding. I focus way better, and I believe my prayers more when I hear them. Something between my mouth and my ears helps me understand, this is what I'm actually asking God for. Otherwise, it's just kind of like, oh, God, it'd be great if you did something today. He's saying, talk to me, ask me, trust me. Now, the one last piece of armor here before we move on is put on the salvation as your helmet. Salvation meaning that God has already saved us, right? Which we've talked about. This is, again, part of just the whole gospel. But I do like this picture of salvation, that this word, it just means sustains your life. And it's in the Greek word, it's at its root, at its most basic usage in the Greek language, they would talk about, like, for example, how a fish that gets caught in a net and pulled into a boat and flops out of the boat and lands back in the water, he was saved. Why? Because the water's his salvation. It's where he lives. It's where he's got life. Outside of that water, he's dead. He's suffocating, right? He can't breathe. He can't live. He can't survive. Salvation is that God has brought you into this relationship with him, which is where you were meant to live, how you were meant to live. It's the life you need. Now, this is where it gets hard sometimes for us to recognize, sometimes to understand. You're physically alive. Don't stop breathing. Don't stop eating. Like, don't stop exercising. Don't stop going to work, right? That's the physical side of life. But we know this physical body is dying. This physical world is dying. Jesus has come, and he died, and he rose from the dead to connect us with both God, who is our spiritual life, and because he's going to remake this physical broken world into a spiritual, physical new world that's going to be all about life. But it starts right now. He's saying, come into this relationship and remind yourself, you are walking with the God who can give you life. Give you not physical breath, but that spiritual breath. He's going to place his Holy Spirit inside of us. In fact, that's the very next part. He says, and take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit at all times on every occasion. Stay alert and be persistent in your prayers for all believers everywhere. And there's two pieces to this spirit piece here that is really important. And that is the word of God and prayer. He kind of puts them both into, these are spirit-given activities, spirit-given habits, spirit-given tools. And the sword, the weapon, if you will, is the word of God. But remember, this is the spiritual battle. So this is not about you hitting somebody over the head with your Bible, right? Physically or metaphorically. He's saying this is the way that we understand this battle against Satan, is we're going to find his truth in his word. This is how we're going to combat his lies, have his accusations, his deception. It's where we find this foundation, the story of what it is. And he's going to use that story and work that into the depths of our heart and our mind, because the Holy Spirit is going to help us understand, oh yeah, you know what? This is about you. It's not just about you. It's about all believers, but it's also just about you. And it's all about history, and it's about the future, and it's about God, and it's also about you. I mean, it's all of these things woven into here. And this Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God, it's going to come through God's word, and it's going to come through this simple thing that we just call prayer. Like, these are the most basic aspects and qualities of what it is to follow after Jesus, but he's saying this is part of our armor, part of our defense, and part of our offense. We need these things in our life as habits, as rituals, as ways in which we equip ourselves every day, every morning, our mind and our hearts before we head off into our day, into this wild world, into this place where there's this, well, more spiritual battle going on than we often understand or can wrap our heads around. But he's saying it's there, and this is how you can prepare for it. And he closes almost the whole letter out with this. He says, and pray for me too. Ask God to give me the right words so I can boldly explain God's mysterious plan, that the good news is for Jews and Gentiles alike. saying, pray for me because I'm in prison right now, and you know what? I need this as much as anybody. I have to keep putting this on just like everybody else. I have to remember to do this or I can get discouraged. I can get distracted. That's why I'm writing these letters and getting letters back. It keeps me focused. It reminds me that this is a bigger picture, that this is more of the church. He says, I'm in chains now, still preaching this message as God's ambassador. So pray that I will keep on speaking boldly for him as I should. And I love that Paul is kind of coming back to the big picture here a moment. One, it's partly it's pray for me, absolutely. But when you're praying for me, pray for me that I'll keep being focused on the bigger picture of what God is doing, what God has called me into. How God is using me to spread this word. And he's talking about even like the soldiers that are chained to him in his prison and all these kind of things. But this is also true for us to remember we're part of the bigger picture. We're part of the bigger church. We're part of the bigger story and the battle of what God is doing in this world. We're in this battle line with our armor on and our weapons on, living in this world, fighting this battle because Satan has been cast down to earth. And we may not have the answer to all the spiritual problems or all the physical problems or the political problems or all the tragedies that we see around us, but we do have the answer to the spiritual problem. Or another way of saying this, we have the answer to what people can have hope in. We have the answer to what people can have faith and trust in that is actually reliable and powerful and real. We have the answer to what God wants to do in any given individual, in our family, in our friend group, in our office. And we're the people who have that message, that testimony, that story of what God has done, what Jesus has accomplished, the hope that he's given us. This last week I was talking with Katrina Turnips here, our children's director, and she was just sharing how she has a neighbor that she knows and has known for a long time, but not super well. And so they were talking about this last year and a half, and the neighbor was just sharing how hard COVID had been on her and how much there was depression and the struggle and all of these things that were going on. And Katrina hadn't realized, you know, what the whole story. And as she was listening, you know, she just got a chance to share, you know, I don't have all the answers by any means, but here's what I know God has done, because I have the same fears. I have the same insecurities. I've got the same challenges raising my kids. But here's what Jesus has done with my fears. Here's what he's done with my insecurities. Here's what he's done with all of these challenges and what I've gained from trusting him and following him. And that was it. And then she invited her to come to church. I thought, that is such an awesome picture, because that's who we are in this world. We're just people who have answers to the most ordinary and basic human problems in life. That our problems are not just about what we're going to eat or our next breath or our physical health. Those are all real issues, real problems. But there's a whole lot of spiritual, psychological, emotional challenges that God has got all the answers for. And not just answers in our head, but answers he wants to put in our hearts, in our minds. And he wants to use us as his people to help fight that battle. Help fight it through bringing peace, understanding what that righteousness means, understanding that this salvation is for everyone. Or if we just put it in our kind of more normal terms, it's why it's all about knowing God. He invites us to know God, and he wants to invite your neighbors and friends to know him. It's all about that relationship through Christ, and in that we find freedom from our fears, from our anxieties, from our depressions, from our discouragement, right? From our sin and our past. Because God has made every single one of us with a purpose. I mean, as much as we all want to find happiness and pleasure and enjoyment in life, all of those things that this world offers, at some point in time, they all break down. They leave you just wanting more. And I always find it fascinating that what God promises is purpose. In my purpose, that's where you're going to find and discover real joy. That's where you're going to discover real happiness. That's where you're going to discover real satisfaction, because God knows what he made you to be, who he made you to be, in his own image. It's when we get to that place that we realize, you know what? As I listen to my friends, as I listen to my family, as I listen to my coworkers, there's a difference to be made here. Sometimes it's just by being a voice of peace. Sometimes it's just by being someone who's stable and calm, someone who's like, wow, I don't know the answer, but I'm going to be praying for all of these people. Sometimes it means just sharing my story of what God has done in my life. This is the cool piece of what Paul is saying. These little things, this is how the battle gets fought and won. This is how more people get rescued out of that kingdom of darkness, of hopelessness, of despair, of sadness, lostness. And he's saying that this is something that all of us as people can be a part of. So we're going to pray, and as we pray, I want to invite you guys all to stand with me. because it's been a long sermon and those chairs are really comfortable. Seventh inning stretch. Okay, it's actually like top of the ninth. But just let's pray together. And you notice this whole thing started by him saying, at the end of this all, you're going to be standing. Because in their day and age, soldiers fought on their feet. If you were on the ground, you were pretty much going to get hosed. So we stand in this posture saying, like, we're ready for the fight. We're ready for the battle. We just need to remember that we have to add these things to our lives if we're going to go out in this world equipped. So let's just pray together. And I'm going to pray out loud, of course. But you guys, be praying to God to help you develop that. To not just let that go in as information, but that for how that truth, that righteousness, that salvation, that peace becomes a part of your life, your heart, your mind, your story. God can do it. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you are alive and active and working in this world in more ways than we fully understand. But God, we also appreciate the knowledge and understanding that there is an enemy also at work in this world. And to the degree that it's helpful, help us to see and understand what that looks like in our life, how that's affecting the world around us, how that's affecting the people around us, how that's affecting our household, how that's affecting our thinking and our feeling. Father, help us to see and understand the truth behind the spiritual battle, but remind us that you've already won the war. Remind us that you've given us the tools that we need, the equipment we need. Father, get us past the distractions. Get us past the discouragement that we can begin to put on this armor, that we remember that truth, that we dive into your word and the spirit and prayer, that you would fill us with all the confidence we need to know our salvation and our righteousness and our peace is yours, that like Paul prayed, we could be bold in our faith and just living it out, living out that purpose, living out that joy, living out that peace. Father, we pray that we would just be aligned with you. Lord, in this very week, as we step into our own real world full of physical struggles, physical challenges, difficult people, God, that we would be able to walk in it a little differently. We would just take a step in that direction, that we would begin our day, our morning, a little bit of your word, a little bit of prayer, that we would be reminded before we go into that meeting or we hop into that car and head out the traffic and we wake up our kids in the morning, we would take that moment to seek you first, to come back to your word for truth, power. We would understand that you are offering us great strength, and we need it. Jesus, thank you for not leaving us on our own. I pray all this in your name.
Was born with
what a Savior.
Oh, what a Savior. Isn't He wonderful? Sing alleluia. Christ is risen. Bow down before Him, for He is Lord of all. Sing alleluia. Christ is risen. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Bear your cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
Those are great last words there. Tell all the world the treasure you found. One time where God encourages bragging. Brag about how great God has worked in your life. How cool is that? Well, Bayside, last couple of things here before we head out, and that is, one, we got to take an offering. Yes, I know. I love it. We get to give back to God a little bit of how He has blessed us, and you can do most of that electronically. It's been the easy way through all of COVID, but don't forget, we have our big wooden box. It's actually a small wooden box in the back, and you can stick anything you want in there as long as it's valuable. I would also like just to ask you guys to pray with me real quickly, because there's a guy in our church, Bob Newman. Many of you know him. He's got COVID right now and isn't doing great, and normally I wouldn't bring up necessarily just a single prayer request, but Bob has been running our prayer and fasting ministry very quietly behind the scenes for longer than I've been a part of Bayside. He fasts, and I'm not making this up or exaggerating, every single day, all breakfast every day. And if you know Bob and you look at him, you're like, he likes his food. So it's a legit, he fasts it. He does that, and he keeps up all the prayers. He's got prayer requests going back 10 years that he still prays to. He prays it until he's like, it's been answered. And he just sent out a request. He always hesitates to put himself on it, but just like asking for prayer for him as well, because he has more faith in what prayer can do than the bad news his doctors are giving him, though he's listening to their advice, don't get me wrong. And so I thought, you know what? He has prayed for everyone who's ever put in a prayer request, so let's just take some time to pray for Bob and just pray for God's healing, or as Bob would say, for whatever God wants to do. But he'd really like to make it to 80 next month, because he just thinks it sounds cooler than dying at 79. So let's pray for Bob Newman. Father, you know your servant and your son, Bob. You know what an amazing servant he is. How he loves to be behind the scenes. How he loves to talk with you. How he loves to lift up the prayers that get brought to you. And how much he trusts and believes in your answers. That you will answer. That you will work. That you do show up. And he's got his list of ways that you have answered his prayers over the years. Father, we just ask that you would be with him right now. That you would be merciful. You would just stretch out your hand, that you would heal his body, help it to overcome COVID, help overcome this virus. Father, we pray that you'd restore him. But we pray more than anything that you would walk closely with him right now. That you would be his peace. You continue to be his purpose. You be his joy. Father, we ask that you would keep him with us for a long time. We love you. We pray this all in your great name. Amen. Last thing is just a practical thing, and that is, how do you even begin to make these things a habit that we talked about? And one thing I would just recommend is a really cool tool. The YouVersion app is a Bible app that you can download on your phone. It has a gazillion things on it that are cool, from videos, but it has prayer or Bible plans, including a gazillion on spiritual warfare. I was going to try to pick one out and tell you to do it, but I'm like, there's like five or six great ones right here at the top. So who am I to pick? But I recommend, if you don't know how to start this subject, start right there. YouVersion, which is spelled Y-O-U as in you, and then version. And download it, find one of their Bible reading plans, just type in spiritual warfare or spiritual disciplines. Some great things will come up. Just do that at the beginning of each day. Let that be where you begin to develop the habit of equipping yourself with God's incredible truth, his salvation, his righteousness, his peace, all this stuff. So that's really good. That's really practical. All right, so here's the thing. We're all heading out of here as warriors equipped with our armor, right? We're going out of here ready to be strong, right? Yes, we are. There it is. I like it. It's flexing. Exactly. So guys, turn to your fellow warrior and just remind them, you will leave here even stronger if you have pizza with us first. See you guys outside in just a minute. You can go right outside that door, or you can walk all the way around after you pick up your kids, whatever you want, but just go that way. You can pull on Eric's hair as you're going by. Just don't knock over the equipment.